people from Morocco. In the name of not alienating their allies, the bourgeois parties, and also in reality because they did not want to upset England and France, they thought that the so-called democratic countries would support them against the fascists. They did not want to liberate a colony, because if you liberate one colony in North Africa, all the other North African colonies would demand independence. If you liberate Spanish Morocco, French Morocco and Algeria would demand independence the next day. So they did not declare independence for Morocco. Had they done so, Abdel Karim from prison appealed to them that get me released, let me go back to Morocco, I will fight against Franco, I will mobilize the Moors so that they are not supporting the right wing. They did nothing about that either. So colonial independence was put on hold until fascism has been defeated. Second, because the big capitalists were going in the direction of Franco, in Barcelona, led by the CNT and the PUM, the workers seized the factories. The best description is in a book by somebody who was close to the anarchists. George Orwell wrote an account called Homage to Catalonia, where he describes the Catalan Revolution. Workers' councils took over the factories, and then the Communist Party prevailed upon the CNT leaders, the C from Madrid, not from Barcelona. And the Communists and the CNT went and urged the workers to give the factories back to the owners, because this is not the socialist revolution yet, and therefore, so it was a dogmatic conception that this is a particular stage of revolution. At this stage, these things cannot be done. Not a question of the dynamics of the revolution. The bourgeois allies in whose name they were doing this were actually flocking more and more to Franco. What happened as a result was that the left wing of the anarchists, Durruti and his supporters, and the PUM were eventually to be isolated. Many of them were arrested. The PUM was eventually declared illegal. Nin was arrested. In 1978 or 80, Santiago Carrillo, the general secretary of the Spanish Communist Party, admitted that members of the Communist Party dressed in Franco's troops uniform had taken Nin away from the prison, because the story given out was that he is a fascist agent. He has been rescued from prison by the fascists. Actually, it was members of the Communist Party who took him away and killed him. So they felt that the main threat came from ultra-lefts, like left-wing anarchists and dissident communists, and that the Popular Front meant keeping the bourgeois state in a democratic form for the moment, nothing more. The result was a constant demobilization and decline in the militant spirit of the working class. And finally, even if this is a bourgeois revolution, there was a question of land distribution, on which once again nothing significant was done, because the whole argument was that first defeat the fascists, everything else comes after that. The two-way dynamics, the point of class struggle, that the working class and the poor peasants are fighting fascism as part of their class struggle, and that therefore it is necessary to advance their class struggle. This was not a lesson that the Communist Party was able to draw. With the result that by early 1938 it was clear that it was lost. Although they held on for nearly one more year, it was only in January or February 1939 that Madrid finally fell to Franco, and those who fled across the border to France, a huge number were arrested and put in prison, quite a significant number were executed. There were many tales of heroism, a real internationalism shown at that time by the creation of the International Brigade, where volunteers from many countries went, primarily mobilized by communists of different countries to fight in the civil war. Even that, the government backed down because France and England insisted that why are you letting foreigners enter? So Hitler's weapons, Hitler's planes, these were not significant. But the so-called democratic countries actually blocked everything. For Hitler and for Mussolini, this was important. The assistance they gave to Franco was also a way of trying out their weapons of war, seeing how good their planes were, how good their tanks were. In a sense, the Spanish Civil War saw the Soviet Union and the Germans trying out their weapons, because the Soviets sent a certain amount of military aid to the Republic. So the Soviet tanks did come, as long as the Republicans had ports through which they could get this. But beyond this, the whole point of the Popular Front that the democratic bourgeoisie would help proved to be a crucial stumbling block. And once again, what has happened is, if on the extreme left of the communist movement, the Sixth Congress line has remained as an error which periodically recurs, the Seventh Congress line on the right wing of the communist movement has become a permanent feature, where there are these routine arguments that in order to fight fascism, I remember, and there are probably a few people in this audience who will remember, that in 1974, the JP movement was denounced by the CPI as fascist. And therefore, they even supported Indira Gandhi's proclamation of emergency in the name of anti-fascism. The whole logic was that by proclaiming the emergency, Indira Gandhi has stopped fascism, therefore this is to be supported. On the other hand, the CPIM was calling Indira Gandhi semi-fascist, and therefore they joined the JP movement under political terms which were extremely humiliating for any working class organization, because JP was organizing big rallies everywhere. In Calcutta, at that stage, the RSS had negligible forces, the socialists had negligible forces. So JP knew that if the CPM wasn't brought in, then the demonstration would be hardly a few thousand. If the CPM was brought in, lakhs would be brought out on the street. But he did not want the CPM's identity to be openly presented. So he said that the conditions are, it must be a bannerless demonstration. And the CPM said, yes, in the interest of a united front, we will go without our banner. So the whole demonstration was actually a CPIM demonstration, but led by JP. CPIM provides the cadre base, working class leaders, student cadres, they go and it's projected as JP, and they are explaining to their cadres that we are doing it because we are fighting fascism. So the two big parliamentary communist parties on the opposite side supporting two bourgeois formations in the name of fighting fascism, that is what it came down to in 1974. So these are, I mean, it's a depressing history in a sense, the number of defeats that the working class had, but it's crucial for us to understand why these defeats occurred and what are we going to do in the present context. I mean, all I can do, if we are looking at the history, all I can do is sum it up and say that the United Front is a fighting front. Election is only a component. It is not a pure electoral bloc, even if it's only between workers' parties. Unless there is a militant component, there is no point of the United Front. There's no way that bourgeois parties can be part of such a united front. In other words, the whole notion of fighting the RSS by allying with the Congress, I heard that in recent times some of the CPI leaders have spoken favorably about Shashi Kala, presumably because they want to fight the RSS by again allying with AIADMK. Their whole history of once allying with the DMK, once allying with the ADMK. This notion of bourgeois allying with bourgeois parties in the name of anti-fascism is one which has had historically only one result. The CPI was practically wiped out from West Bengal for 20 years because of what it did in 1975. It was about half the size of the CPM in 1971-72. It became about 5 to 8% the size of the CPM in terms of its power, ability to influence by 1980 because of the political alliances, the nature of the political alliances it had made. The fact that the CPM was originally saved was because of the bourgeoisie and not CPM. In 1977, in the name of fighting fascism, CPM again wanted an alliance with Janata Party. But the Janata leaders demanded an absurd number of seats. So the talks broke down. The result was a left front was elected all by itself. Had the Janata leadership been a little less greedy, what would have happened was the kind of bloc government that have happened everywhere else, and whatever limited reforms that the CPIM did, which made it possible for it to have such a long innings in West Bengal, would simply not have happened. So, and yet, this is something that these parties seem to be utterly incapable of understanding. Having lost the elections, the only thing they could think of was how to win elections. So, you have the rise of the RSS, the BJP, and you have the TMC clearly making Muslim communalism one of its components, the way it's been functioning. Instead of taking up a class and anti-communal political campaign for 5 years, the CPIM bullied its reluctant partners, because this time the CPI and the RSP were reasonably reluctant to go into an alliance with the Congress. With a strange reversal of history, the CPI was originally the party which wanted an alliance with Congress, and the CPI and the party which was not so happy with that. The CPI bullied them into it. The result was actually that the votes, see, it was such an opportunist thing. They have not even done any long struggle with the Congress. You can't do any long struggle with the Congress. That's a different thing. Their assumption was arithmetic, that in the parliamentary elections, Congress had got this much, we had got this much. So all we have to do is, we leaders announce to the masses that we have formed an alliance, automatically the masses will go and vote. Masses do not have any brains, masses do not think. So it doesn't matter. This is the other key issue, that masses do think, masses are discouraged. If instead of militant battles, we simply push them either towards sectarianism or towards a politics where the bourgeois system is in command. So this is the, beyond, we can go beyond it, but that would be talking about the present, not really about what we learn about anti-fascism from the past. So the final thing would be one component which was taken up not at all by the communists, which was their failure to combat the Nazis, particularly ideologically. In the case of Franco, in the case of Mussolini, this was less so, because they did not make ideology such a central pillar. Hitler was constantly fighting elections, so he was using ideology, his anti-Semitism and his nationalism. The problem is, if you look at communist propaganda, occasionally you find anti-imperialism and anti-Versailles becoming synonymous. It's not the same thing. Versailles is a struggle between different imperialist powers. But if I am living in an imperialist country, what's my position? It's not identical in India. But if we look at the mainstream Indian left, this is a parallel error. For them, the ideological struggle is a very small component. The ideological struggle involves capture ICHR, capture UGC. The moment BJP government goes away, make sure that ICHR goes to some pro-left professor, whatever. The real ideological struggle, because the BJP is not, RSS is not always bothered by the top level. What they are doing is, from school level onwards, the kind of socialization through which they are getting. See, I teach in a university, I have taught history for many years, and we have this problem that these children, by the time they are coming into college, they have a communal mindset if they have been taught in a particular way. So if we teach history in a different way, they assume that, oh, this is a lefty professor, so in his answer script, I have to write these things, otherwise I may not get marks. But don't believe what he's saying, he's talking bullshit. The real thing is, of course, that Muslims were always the enemies, etc., etc., etc. How do you fight this? You don't fight this simply by, yeah, it's important, because if they capture UGC, they can do important things. They are doing important things. Like at the university level, we are now getting orders which journals to buy and which journals not to buy. But the vast masses of India aren't in the universities. It's at that lower level. The left, the mainstream left, what struggles have they done in the last 20 years against the RSS in that field? Another area, because it's not Muslims. It's ultimately, as I said, for Hitler, for Mussolini, for the RSS, as we can see, it's nationalism. And this is a question point where all you have to do is see Sitaram Yechury talk about Kashmir, the mainstream left leaders talk about the nation, the language in which they talk, that they have completely internalized the discourse of nation and nationalism to such an extent that